Hello, everyone. Thank you again so very much for being with us today. Thank you for taking the time to study God's word with us as we this week take a really brief look at the book of Job. You could say this really about any book of the Bible, but this seems to be especially true of Job. This is one of those books where just spending the amount of time we're going to spend on it just seems way too brief, because this book really pushes the reader towards some of those huge existential questions. Why? Why, God? Before we go any farther into Job, though, I do want to just take a moment with a verse from Psalm 46. Be still and know that I am God. It's the great comfort of Psalm 46. But if you think about it, interestingly enough, it's also the stern admonition of the book of Job. That phrase, be still and know that I am God, very rightly calls to mind comfort and hope for the believer. But that phrase also helps unlock some of what the writer of Job is getting at in his book. This book seeks to answer a particular question, but it's not the one most of us Westerners want answered. Most of us Westerners want the question answered, why, God, do you let bad things happen to good people? That's the one we want answered. The writer of Job, though, takes our question and says, hold on a second. Who is God? And the answer that the writer ultimately settles on, inspired by the Holy Spirit, is be still. Be still and know that I am God, the all-wise, all-powerful creator of the universe, who's going to make sure everything that needs to get done gets done, whose will and work will be accomplished. Be still. And let me be in charge. That lesson of Job is critically important to understanding, really, the whole book. It's critical to understanding the nature of God. And, God willing, as you perhaps take time to read the book of Job, in the end, God willing, you can, like Job, find peace in letting God be God, as we live our own lives in view of his awesome might and grace. So, with that, let's look at a few things related to the book before we get to the videos. There's actually two videos this week, one that runs about 7 minutes and one that runs about 11 minutes. Following the videos, we'll come back, kind of talk through the content of those videos very briefly, just put a couple of questions out there. As always, if you have questions, if you have comments, drop them in the comments below. We'll do everything we can to answer them quickly and briefly. If you want to get a hold of me directly, feel free to drop me an email, a text. Find me on Facebook and let me know what that question is, and I'll do my best to answer it for you. So getting into the content here of the book ever so briefly here, the author of the book of Job is unknown. Job is obviously the main character, but we don't really have any idea who the author is. It can be surmised that the author is a Jew. That much we can gather, simply because the name of the Lord, the covenant name, the Lord, shows up regularly, quite often within the book. And this is somebody who seems to understand the core of the Old Testament faith. The time and place of the events of Job are also essentially unknown. The author possibly wrote during the time of Solomon, when other wisdom literature is being collected, but that's semi-educated conjecture. Also, Job, it seems quite possible, some might even say likely, that he lived somewhere in the Fertile Crescent, somewhere in ancient Mesopotamia, perhaps. But again, that's all a semi-educated conjecture. Many people will place Job about the time of Abraham based on a number of internal factors within the book. Again, quite possible, but we really don't know. In fact, one of the interesting things about the book of Job, outside of how challenging it is, both in terms of content and if you studied any Hebrew, or if you know anybody who studied any Hebrew, Job is not what they give a first year Hebrew student. It's some of the most difficult Hebrew you will run across. That poetry is extremely dense. But one of the things that you do find in the book of Job is that the author actually seems to intentionally leave out some of that historical context stuff that we Westerners always find so fascinating. How is this connected to so-and-so? Where does this fall in the timeline? What is the context? And the author seems to be intentionally stripping that away so that it forces us to focus on the message of the story of the book. And there are at least two things in Job that we can say that are pretty crystal clear. One is that God's definition of justice and the execution of that justice is not as black and white as we would like it to be. In fact, one of the things Job forces us to confront is that way too often, we human beings are way too simplistic when it comes to how we look at justice. The second thing in the book is that not all pain and suffering is the result of sin. Sometimes we have an idea of why something happens, and sometimes something's going to happen that we just don't have, at least this side of heaven anyway, that we have an answer to. But in it all, God is in control. And as we get into the videos now, those are going to be two themes that come out very clearly and very powerfully in the book. One is that God is just, but we need to be careful not to import our definition of justice on God. And then again, two, suffering, well, it has a purpose. It's not always the result of sin, and we may sometimes never, at least this side of heaven, know the purpose. So we'll continue at this time with the videos. Following the videos, again, we'll come back, walk through the content of them just a little bit, talk about a couple of questions. Thank you again for being with us.
There are three books in the Bible known as the wisdom literature: Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Job. The first, Proverbs, showed us that God is wise and just.
Yeah, we learned that God has ordered the world so that it's fair. The righteous are rewarded, the wicked are punished. In other words, you get what you deserve.
But then we meet Ecclesiastes, who observes, people don't always get what they deserve.
He said the world isn't always fair, that life is unpredictable and hard to comprehend, just like smoke.
And this makes you wonder, is God wise and just?
Exactly. And so it's that question that is being explored in the final book of wisdom, Job.
All right, let's dive in.
So Job begins with a strange story that takes place up in the heavens, which are described something like a heavenly command center. So God is there with these angelic creatures called the sons of God, and they're all there reporting for duty.
And God points out this guy Job, his servant, showing how righteous and good he is.
And then one of these angelic creatures approaches. He's referred to in Hebrew as the Satan.
The Satan? Who is this?
Well, this word is actually a title, which literally means the one who is opposed. So out of this whole crew, he is the one questioning how God is running the world. And he proposes that Job might not actually love God, that he's only a good person because God rewards him. If God were to take away all of the good things he gave to Job, then we would see his true colors.
So he thinks Job is just working the system?
That's exactly right. Maybe he's obeying just to get what he wants.
So God agrees to this experiment and allows the Satan to inflict suffering on Job.
And Job loses everyone and everything that he cares about. It is devastating. And remember, he deserves none of this. God himself said so.
The remarkable thing is that in the midst of all this suffering, Job still praises God.
At least for chapters 1 and 2. But then in chapter 3, we find out how he's really feeling inside. He unleashes this poem that reveals his devastation. It's a long, elaborate curse on the day that he was born.
After this, some of Job's friends come to visit him to offer their help. And all of them are like, Job, you must have done something horribly wrong to deserve this. After all, we know God is just, and we know the world is ordered by God's justice and fairness, so you must be getting what you deserve.
And for the next 34 chapters, the friends and Job go back and forth in very dense Hebrew poetry. His friends keep speculating about why God might have sent such suffering, and they even start making up lists of hypothetical sins that Job must have committed. But after each accusation, Job defends his innocence.
And Job is innocent.
He is. He's also on an emotional roller coaster. At some moments, he's very confident that God is still wise and just.
Yeah, in other moments, he's doubting God's goodness.
He even comes to accuse God of being reckless, unfair, and corrupt. So by the end of the dialogue, Job demands that God come and explain himself in person, and God does so. He comes in the form of a great storm cloud.
Now, God doesn't give Job a direct answer. He doesn't tell Job about the conversation with the Satan.
Yeah, he does something very different. He takes Job on a virtual tour of the universe. He shows Job how grand the world is, and he asks him if he's even capable of running it or understanding it, just for a day. He shows Job how much detail there is in the world, things that we might see every day, but really don't understand at all. But God does. He knows it all intimately. He pays attention to the beauty and operations of the universe in ways that we haven't even imagined and in places that we will never see.
Then to conclude, God shows Job two wondrous beasts and brags about how great they are.
Yeah, they are dangerous. I mean, they would kill you without even thinking about it. And God says they're not evil. They're actually a part of his good world.
And then that's it. That's God's whole defense. It's kind of weird. I mean, what was this all about?
It seems to be this. From Job's point of view, it looks like God is not just. But God's perspective is infinitely bigger. He's dynamically interacting with a whole universe of complexity when he makes decisions. And this is what God calls his wisdom.
So Job asking God to defend himself is actually kind of absurd.
He couldn't comprehend this kind of complexity even if he wanted to.
So where does this leave us?
Well, it leaves Job in a place of humility. He never learned why he suffered, and yet he's able to live in peace and in the fear of the Lord.
But that's not where the book ends, because after this, God restores to Job double everything he had lost. And this, again, is surprising. I mean, is this a reward? Is God saying, congratulations, Job, you passed this elaborate test?
No, I mean, the whole book just made the point that Job losing everything was not a punishment, and so now getting it back isn't a reward.
So why does he get it back?
Well, apparently, God, in his wisdom, decided to give Job a gift. We don't know why. But what we do know is that Job is now the kind of person who, no matter what comes, good or bad, he can trust God's wisdom.
And that's the book of Job and the end of our wisdom series.
These biblical books of wisdom are amazing. Each one offers a unique perspective on the good life, and you need to hear all of them together as you learn to live with wisdom and in the fear of the Lord.
The book of Job, it's a profound and very unique book in the Bible for lots of reasons. The story is set in a very obscure land that's far away from Israel, Uz. The main character, Job, he's not even an Israelite. And the author, who's anonymous, doesn't even set the story in any clear period of ancient history. This all seems intentional, though. It's like the author doesn't want us to be distracted by historical questions, but rather to focus simply on the story of Job and on the questions raised by his experience of suffering. The book of Job has a very clear literary design. It opens and closes with a short narrative prologue and then an epilogue. And then the central body of the book is dense Hebrew poetry, representing conversations between Job and four dialogue partners called the friends. These conversations are then concluded by a series of poetic speeches given by God to Job. Let's dive in and we'll just see how it works together. The prologue introduces us to Job, and we're told that he's a blameless, upright man who honors God. He's a super good guy. And then all of a sudden, we're transported into the heavenly realms, and God is holding court with his staff team. It's a very common image in the Old Testament describing how God runs the world. And among the heavenly beings is a figure called the Satan, which in Hebrew means the accuser or the prosecutor. And it's like we're watching a court scene. God presents Job as a truly righteous man, and then the accuser challenges God's policy of rewarding righteous people like Job. He says, "The only reason Job obeys you is because you bless him with prosperity. Let Job suffer, then we'll see how righteous he actually is." And then God agrees to let the accuser inflict suffering on Job. Now, it's at this point in the story that most of us go, "What? Why did God do that?" And then we assume that this book is going to answer that question, why God allows good people to suffer. But as you read on, the book doesn't answer that question. Nothing in the book ever answers that question. The prologue is setting up the real questions this book is trying to get at. Questions about God's justice and whether God operates the universe according to the strict principle of justice. And the response to those questions comes as you read through to the end of the book, not at the beginning. The ultimate reason for Job's suffering is simply never revealed. So the prologue concludes with a suffering and bewildered Job, who's rebuked by his wife, and he's approached by three friends who are going to try and provide wisdom and counsel. Their names are Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite. They're all non-Israelites like Job. And they represent the best of ancient Near Eastern thinking about God and suffering and the human condition, and this moves us into the main part of the book. First, Job speaks. And this is how this section of the book works. First, Job is going to speak, and then they'll follow a response from a friend. Then Job will respond to that friend. Then another friend will respond to Job's response, and so on back and forth for three cycles. And this whole debate is focused on three questions. Is God truly just in character? And does God run the universe on the strict principle of justice? And if so, then how is Job's suffering to be explained? As we're going to see, Job and the friends, they're working from a huge assumption about what God's justice ought to look like in the world. Namely, that every single thing that happens in the universe should operate according to the strict principle of justice. So if you're a wise, good person and you honor God, good things will happen to you. God will reward you. But if you're evil and stupid and do sinful things, bad things will happen to you. God will punish you. Now, Job's constant argument throughout his speeches is this. First of all, that he's innocent, and so the implication of that is that his suffering is not a divine punishment. Now, we know from the prologue, both of these things are true. Remember, God himself said, Job is righteous and blameless. And so Job concludes his argument by accusing God. God either doesn't run the world according to justice, or even worse, God himself is simply unjust. The friends, on the other hand, they beg to differ. Their argument is that God is just, the implication being that God always runs the world according to justice in this way. And so they conclude by accusing not God, but Job. Job must have done something really, really bad for God to punish him like this. They even start making up possible sins that Job must have committed. Job protests to all of this. In fact, he gets so fed up with the friends that he eventually just gives up on them. He takes up his case directly with God. Now, something to be aware of is that Job, he's on an emotional roller coaster in these poems. He used to think that God is just, but now he can't reconcile that with his suffering. And so in some outbursts, Job, he'll accuse God of being a bully. Once he even declares that God has orchestrated all the injustice in the world. But the moment he utters that thought, he's terrified of it because he wants to hope and believe that God is truly just. Job is all over the place in this section. And so he makes one last statement of his innocence, and then he demands that God show up personally to explain himself. Now, it's at this point that a surprise friend shows up, Elihu the Buzite. Now, he's not an Israelite, but he does have a Hebrew name. And Elihu, he has the same assumption as Job and the friends. He argues that God is just, and that that implies that God always operates the universe according to justice. But then Elihu draws a more sophisticated conclusion about why good people suffer. It may not be punishment for sin in the past. God might inflict suffering as a warning to help people avoid sin in the future. Or God might use pain and suffering to build character or to teach people valuable lessons. Elihu doesn't claim to know why Job is suffering, but one thing he is certain of: Job is wrong to accuse God of being unjust. Job doesn't even respond to Elihu, and the dialogues come to a close. It's like the wisdom of the ancients has been spent, and the mystery remains. And then, all of a sudden, God shows up in a whirlwind, and he responds to Job personally. He first responds to Job's accusation that he's unjust and incompetent at running the universe. So God takes Job on a virtual tour of the universe, and he starts asking him all these questions about the order and origins of the cosmos. Was Job ever around when God architected the earth or organized the constellations? Has Job ever commanded the sunrise or controlled the weather? God has his eyes on all of these cosmic details that Job has never even conceived of. Then God starts going into detail, describing the grazing habits of mountain goats and how deer give birth, or the feeding patterns of lions and wild donkeys. What's the point of all this? Remember the assumption of Job and his friends about what it looks like for God to run the world according to justice. Underneath that assumption is a deeper one, that Job and his friends have a wide enough perspective on life to make such a claim about how God ought to run the world. And God's response with this virtual tour, it deconstructs all of these assumptions. It first of all shows that the universe is a vast, complex place, and that God has his eyes on all of it, every detail. Job, on the other hand, has only the small horizon of his life experience to draw from. His view of the world is very limited. And so what looks like divine injustice, from Job's point of view, needs to be seen in an infinitely larger context. Job is simply not in a position to make such a huge accusation about God. After the virtual tour, God asks Job if he would like to micromanage the world for a day, according to the strict principle of justice that Job and his friends assume, punishing every evil deed of every person at every moment with precise retribution. The fact is that carrying out justice in a world like ours, it's extremely complex. It's never black and white, like Job and the friends seem to think. Which leads to God's last point. He starts describing these two fantastic creatures, Behemoth and Leviathan, which some people think are poetic depictions of a hippo and a crocodile. But more likely, they refer to well-known creatures from ancient Near Eastern mythology that are used elsewhere in the Bible as symbols of the disorder and danger that exist in God's good world. These creatures, they're not evil. God's actually quite proud of them, but they're not safe either. The point is that God's world is amazing and very good, but it's not perfect or always safe. God's world has order and beauty, but it's also wild and sometimes dangerous, just like these two fantastic creatures. And so we come back to the big question of Job's suffering. Why is there suffering in God's world? Whether it's from earthquakes or wild animals or from other humans, God doesn't explain why. What he says is that we live in an extremely complex, amazing world that at this stage, at least, is not designed to prevent suffering. And that's God's response. Job challenged God's justice. God responds that Job doesn't have sufficient knowledge about our universe to make such a claim. Job demanded a full explanation from God, and what God asked Job for is trust in his wisdom and character. And so, Job responds with humility and repentance. He apologizes for accusing God, and he acknowledges that he's overstepped his bounds. Then all of a sudden, the book concludes with a short epilogue. First, God says that the friends were wrong, that their ideas about God's justice were just too simple, not true to the complexity of the world or God's wisdom. And then God says that Job has spoken rightly about him. Now, this is surprising because it can't apply to everything Job said. I mean, we know Job drew hasty and wrong conclusions, but God still approves of Job's wrestling, how Job came honestly before God with all of his emotion and pain and simply wanted to talk to God himself. And God says that's the right way to process through all of this, through the struggle of prayer. The book concludes with Job having his health, his family, his wealth, all restored, not as a reward for good behavior, but simply as a generous gift from God, and that's the end of the book. So the book of Job, it doesn't unlock the puzzle of why bad things happen to good people. Rather, it does invite us to trust God's wisdom when we do encounter suffering, rather than try and figure out the reasons for it. When we search for reasons, we tend to either simplify God like the friends, or like Job, accuse God, but based on limited evidence. And so the book is inviting us to honestly bring our pain and our grief to God, and to trust that God actually cares and that he knows what he's doing. And that's what the book of Job is all about.
Welcome back. So we're going to get into the content, first focusing on the first shorter full color video with the notes here, and then moving into the regular longer video. Right away at the 110 mark, they bring up a point about who Satan really is. He's a rebellious opposer of God, wanting to disrupt God's plans and God's world. And we're going to talk about that more in a moment about who he is. 149, as we kind of merge into then the problem of suffering, which we brought up at the very beginning here, many will properly focus on that problem and then ask the question, how does that work with God's declared grace and mercy? Again, why would God let bad things happen to good people? But one of the things that we need to see here right away in the beginning of Job that I think sometimes gets passed over is that Satan here is a real malevolent, cruel being. For all his smooth talk, for all the things he does, you know, to take on the form of the angel of light or whatever, right? Here you have a being who, if you think about it, to simply prove a point to God, he's willing to cause not only the total destruction of another man's life, but to kill his kids. Just to prove a point to God. You want to know how cruel and evil the devil is? I don't think you have a better example than the beginning of Job here. He's literally willing to kill Job's children to try to make a point. Utterly cruel. 226, Job's friends, maybe not as cruel as the devil, but at least to our modern ear, they're not terribly compassionate. They come here to help, and instantly, because of their focus on justice, which, again, isn't bad, justice is a part of who God is, they essentially say, okay, if God is just and God punishes wickedness, then, Job, you must have done something wrong. What'd you do wrong? And so much of the core of, or so much of the content of the main part of the book is Job's friends essentially interrogating him. What'd you do wrong? Was it this? Was it this? Well, maybe he did this. And the whole while, Job is properly protesting his innocence. I didn't do anything, he says. And he's right. But part of the problem here, again, is the fact that Job's friends, much like humanity in general, we see somebody have a tragedy or a problem or something, and the first thought we have, whether we verbalize it or not, so often is, what did they do wrong? What did they do wrong that caused this thing? What in there, to use Eastern mysticism, again, something that comes up here in this book here, is at least the opportunity to talk about Eastern mysticism, particularly Hinduism and the karmic wheel. It's a part of our thinking more than we realize. We look at what people do wrong or things that happen to them that are good and bad, and we assume they must be something in them or what they did that deserves it. And that's karma. That's Hinduism. But it's not biblical. One great example we can point to is John chapter 9 here, when Jesus comes upon this man born blind, and the disciples ask the very human question, well, who sinned? Who screwed up? Who did something bad? The man or his parents that he was born blind? And Jesus says, nobody. Nobody sinned. nobody did anything wrong. In fact, Jesus says in this particular man's case, he was born blind so that the glory of God could be revealed in his life. At 334 here, one of the other big questions, and it factors into us asking the question of God, much like Job does at the end of the book. Again, we get to the point, Job, everybody, at least within the common nomenclature of our culture, everybody talks about the patience of Job. That of a book that lasts for 36 chapters, or a little better than 36 chapters, Job's patience actually lasts 2. A lot of the rest of the book is Job in various forms, sometimes fairly mildly, and by the end of the book, fairly angrily yelling and accusing God, yelling at and accusing God. And part of the problem is Job has forgotten who he is. And Job has forgotten who God is, just like we human beings so regularly and routinely do. We forget who we are. We forget who God is. To put it in a little more of an illustration that's comprehensible to us, even though it's not by any means perfect, if God were Einstein, if God were the German scientist Albert Einstein, if that's who he was, compared to him, we're kind of like an amoeba, single-celled organism without a brain. We're tiny compared to him. We're minuscule, both in terms of ability, power, cognition, wisdom. The things that we're responsible for compared to God are so very, very, very small. And yet, we human beings somewhat arrogantly occasionally do shake our fists at heaven, demanding that God give us the answer. And so when God shows up in the storm, it's a good reminder to Job and us. Who's the Lord of heaven and earth? Who's the creator? And who are we? Back to Psalm 46, be still. And remember who is God. The second video starts off with another very good observation that, again, as we said before, the writer of the book seems to strip away a lot of that standard historical context. Where's Job from? Where is friends from? What time did he live? What was going on in the world at that time? He seems to strip that all away in order to make us focus more intentionally on the theme and message of the book. 144 takes us again to that question of why does God allow good people to suffer? And one of the things that the video points out very accurately, actually both videos do, is that the book doesn't answer the question. And it's not sloppy writing, it's intentional. The writer of the book is taking our question, why does God allow good things or bad things to happen to good people? And he's saying, is that really the question we should be asking? And the writer, through again the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, simply chooses not to answer that question and says, no, this is the question we need to talk about. And here's the answer to that question. Who is God? Who are we? Three core questions of the book that this second video lays out. Again, they're all good questions. Is God just? Does God run the universe strictly on the basis of justice? And how is Job's suffering explained? One of the ironies of the book, one of the grand ironies of this book, is that Job, in the end, and Job's friends, and then also true, if we're honest, we often make God too small. One of the ironies of the book is that in their definition of God as being absolutely just and running everything on the basis of absolute justice, at least as they were conceiving of it, they were actually making God smaller than he is. 435 is good. Timestamp 435 in the second video. Again, just to remind or to remember that Job was suffering trauma, and emotionally he was all over the place. And as you're dealing with people, as you yourself perhaps undergo pain and suffering, it's normal to feel like your emotions are all over the place. We see Job in some places giving great confessions of faith as to who God is and what he is. In some places, he's quite literally shaking his fist at heaven. And that's what people going through suffering often find themselves doing. They're back and forth, up and down, all over the place. And then finally, 605. Of all people, it could be argued, who deserved an answer, it was Job, yet he doesn't get one. In fact, God seems to specifically avoid going there because that's not the point. The point could be described this way. He's God. We're not. He's the all-knowing and all-powerful creator of the universe, and we're not. And in the end, one of the great lessons for Job was remembering to be humble and letting God be God and let God be in charge, to be still and know that he's God, to be at peace and to trust him, both his justice and his grace, his wisdom and his mercy for our lives. So, with that, a couple of questions here just to think about. Again, if you want to put answers in the comments below, if you have questions you want to ask about these questions or anything else, drop them in the comments. The questions here: how do you define justice and fairness? How does God define it? Is justice the primary wheel on which we and our world turn? Should justice be the primary wheel on which our lives in this world turns? Some things to think about this week. Thank you for taking the time to be with us today. Thank you for diving here into the book of Job with us. May God bless your week. And Lord willing, we'll see you back here again very soon.